Suhail joined the RP Sanjiv Goenka Group with the responsibility of leading the FMCG business. His journey in the group commenced as President of Business Development and Growth in 2016 and was instrumental in the launch of Brand to Yama. Ladies and gentlemen, his deep experience in investing, having previously co-led McKinsey Institutional Investing Practice in India, enabled the RPSG Group to set up their first consumer oriented early stage venture fund, RPSG Ventures. Please give a big round of applause as we welcome on the stage Suhail Sameer.
Everyone can hear me all right? Okay. This is interesting. Let me actually start with a disclaimer. I don't know marketing too well at all. I'm right place, right time, and lucky enough to run a FMCG business, and it's been an incredible learning journey for me as well. As you've probably heard, my background was actually consulting. I was a partner at McKinsey, and I used to actually lead a very different sector. I used to work in clean tech, all the climate change, carbon emission, renewables is what I used to do. And 2 years back, I had this brain fade moment on I wanted to launch something from scratch, and that's where I joined the group and started the FMCG business. I think what I'm going to try and keep this short. What you're going to hear is a lot which you will already know. Difficult to tell audience like this any rocket science on digital marketing, but I think I'm hopefully trying to go through some of my personal examples and some of my experiences, not necessarily from Tuyam, in fact, very little from Tuyam. The team which created this document had put in lots of videos of Tuyam, which I have, not to their liking, removed from the presentation, right? Because I actually don't feel Tuyam is a great example of what can be done on digital marketing. So I'm going to borrow a lot of examples from brands I like, borrow a few examples from startups you may or may not have heard of, and try and do this. Let me just see. Okay, works. First, a few disclaimers. And given I'm from McKinsey, I will say three. We always have 3 points in McKinsey. So the first one, all images are copy-pasted, so please don't hold me accountable for what you see. I think the second, which is, as you can read, this is a work from two of my very, very lovely brand managers who I think slogged a lot of time last night to get this ready. And I'm going to keep text at a minimum because I've always feel when you have text on the page, then people don't listen to you. This is marketing 1980s, and we had a very lovely conversation in the other room around how marketing used to be early age. Of course, I don't need to talk a lot about this, but you can get the gist. A lot of TV, newspapers, radios, etc., etc. And from there, I think the world started thinking about digital, and I think, but it was a very, I've always thought a lot of companies do a very half-hearted attempt at digital, right? Because you look at digital and you say e-commerce only accounts for 1% of sales, right? So why even bother, right? And sometimes people confuse e-commerce with digital. They are, of course, not they're related, but not necessarily anywhere close to being same. But I think even internally, as we are as a group, we are looking at other categories beyond snacks, which are more e-commerce friendly. But the first question everyone asks me, what is the percentage of e-commerce sales? And I think my conversation with them always is, it's an irrelevant question, because whether your sales will come from e-commerce or not, but where is your consumer, right? He is on his phone, he is on his laptop, and he is not necessarily watching a Saas Bahu serial on TV, right? So, and therefore, digital becomes important. Recently, I came across this data, which basically said, you don't need to make this story any longer, because e-commerce is not only influencing spends, but e-commerce is, or digital is not only influencing spends, but a lot of the stuff will be bought digitally, right? So, and again, a lot of these numbers you will know, beauty, wellness, and personal care is a $17 billion industry in India. In 2020, 70% of this will be influenced digitally, right? So, influenced digitally means either bought online, or researched online before you buy it at the store, right? So, so this is a big number, and roughly half of the internet users will be actually buying products online, right? And this is a big jump from even today, because today this number of people who buy online is around 160, 170 million, right? So this will become 2x in the next 3 years, right? And again, this is forward-looking data, but even if you look at past, this is exactly proved by how, at least in this category, beauty and personal care, how e-commerce has grown, right? So, or how digital buying has grown. The amount of stuff which was bought digitally last year in beauty and personal care were roughly 3,500 crores, and this number was 450 crores 2 years back, right? So, so this is a space which is growing incredibly fast, and will not only, there's a part A of influencing spends, and there's a part B of like, how do you actually start buying online? I think what I'm going to now do is a lot of sort of try and put in context the five phases I see digital evolve over a period of time, and take you through phase by phase. I think this is phase one, which is old world thinking. People will look at product online and buy offline, right? Which is what some of my colleagues who are doing old world businesses like selling fans and ACs, etc. The first thing they did was, let's create a website, let people compare features, etc. Let's get them make the decision offline, and then make the decision online, and then they will go to the store and they will find where is the closest Croma and buy the product from there, right? So this was an important step in the evolution, but I think a lot of more people have moved from there to at least stage two, which is at least start selling online, right? I have an option of buying from your website, list on like whatever 10, 15 platforms, Amazon's, Goki, or whatever is relevant for you, and start selling there. I think these two steps literally are table stakes, right? So if your business is not doing these two, then it's a cause for concern, right? So, and this is where 2M is, unfortunately. I think we've just done step one and step two. But there's a lot more which goes beyond this on doing digital well, right? So this is not even digital. Right? This is just having an online presence so people can discover you, and this is just like basically piggybacking someone else to sell your product on their platform, right? This is, you can literally treat this as one more retailer for you. I think step three, which is where it starts becoming interesting, is when you are using digital to A, identify who your target audience is, and try and connect with them and engage with them. I think I'm just going to actually run a video. This is Durex. If you've not seen Durex's social media handles, all of you should. I'm incredibly impressed with what work they do, and I don't know how do I play this video. Can you play it from there? Just no sound.
Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Morocco, and Tunisia. A wonderful opportunity for Durex Arabia. Why? Because countries playing in major sporting events often experience baby booms 9 months later, as fans celebrate their team's victories with sex. The problem is, in the Middle East, contraceptives can only be advertised on highly regulated social media channels, and any mention of sex can provoke powerful negative reactions. But what if we embraced the risk and turned every game into a reason to celebrate with sex? Not just the victories, but the losses, the draws, the red cards, the unforgettable goals, and more. From the first game to the last, we were able to hijack the Twitter conversation during every match with cheeky new names for our condoms, planned posts that celebrated expected moments, and tactical posts created on the fly during the game became reasons to celebrate with Durex.
Of its generation.
Sends the keeper the wrong way. And
partnering with the region's biggest e-commerce site then allowed us to drive themed Durex bundles for discreet purchase and delivery with every post. While hardline conservatives reacted as expected, the majority of our audience loved it. The engagement rate smashed Twitter's benchmarks by 900% in the biggest market of Saudi Arabia, while e-commerce sales rose over 250% over the same period the previous year, and twice as much as Valentine's Day. At the same time, offline retail sales jumped an incredible 28% across the region. A media cost per engagement 90% below the average meant we were even able to refund 75% of the media budget after the campaign. On Twitter, the organic follower base lifted 128%, generating almost twice the sales leads as Valentine's Day, the peak time of the year. This made us one of the most talked about brands on Twitter in the region during the World Cup, with no official sponsorship or media coverage whatsoever. From being one of the least followed, Durex Arabia is now one of the leading Durex Twitter profiles in the world. The most important result, though, we'll only know that 9 months after the World Cup was lifted.
And you should, if this topic interests you, you should go through some of the work Durex has done. I think first thing you have to get right when you're doing digital is actually treat digital as a separate medium. And we are having again this conversation. Digital doesn't mean I've created a TV ad, let me play it on my social media handle, right? The content has to be different. The objective of digital is engaging with the consumer, right? It's not let me show him my ad and run awareness. For that, TV will probably always be the cheapest medium to get to the consumer. The objective of digital is like get consumers hooked onto content, create a positive net promoter score, et cetera, right? So I think there is another example of KFC, but that I am going to skip. But I think in 30 seconds, what KFC by and large was able to achieve in India is to increase their, they did a lot of these challenges, RJ Hunt, they ran few design your own bucket. This was all done around the last World Cup. And I think what they were able to achieve was to do a 50% increase in NPS scores. On the website, on increased number of followers as you can expect, but more importantly, drive 20% of their sales during that period through online, right? So I think there are lots of interesting stories. I'm happy to go through them later. But I think the fourth stage, which is why are you doing this, right? Eventually, everything comes down to how can I drive sales, right? So I think the step four, which is a which is the important link, and parts of that were actually in the Durex story as well, is how do I convert this engagement into sales? Again, if I'm not going to play this ad, not because I don't want to, but I couldn't find a copy which I can embed in the video. But if you've not seen the burn the whopper or burn that ad work by by Burger King, then you have to see it. It is one of the most, it was one of the most talked about campaigns last year. It was a very simple campaign, right? It was like McDonald's does a lot of ads and lots of boards, etc., across the country. Wherever you see a McDonald's board, just take out your phone and there's an app which you've installed, which is the Burger King app. So first thing, you're driving app downloads. Every time you see a McDonald's ad anywhere on a digital hoarding, on a newspaper, just point to the app and press a button and the ad will burn itself. It was augmented reality and a Burger King burger whopper will come on the screen. And one out of every five consumers will get a free burger. Right? It was a pure, and you may say where is sales because it's a free burger, but you're effectively A, creating a lot of social media buzz, engagement around yourself, but you are potentially getting a customer who was to go into a McDonald's to come into a Burger King instead, have a free burger, I'm sure, but he will not come alone. He will come with five friends, have four more burgers. Maybe he's not even tried the brand, right? It was incredible. They ran this in Brazil. They've taken this year to US, and they're taking this year to Canada. Very, very interesting examples. And there are a few more, but I think the most obvious one is use of augmented reality and digital in creating virtual trial rooms. I don't know, all of you know what a virtual trial room is? Yeah, okay. So this is, A, of course, helps you engage with the consumer, but I think some of the interesting numbers, I was talking to one of my colleagues who used to run this for Myntra, is like the amount of time a consumer spends on the Myntra app, which is one of the way their financial investors evaluate them, has gone more than doubled, right? Because people are, even if they have no intention of buying, they're just browsing through apparel and figuring out what do they like, not like, how will it look on them. And of course, it is leading A to more impulse buys, but more importantly, the conversion on each cloth suddenly goes up, because half the times you like a particular dress, but you don't know how it will look on you, et cetera, and you just leave it, right? So, and this is very, very interesting, and this is done, the technology behind this, now there are two or three people who do this, but is basically created by a bunch of kids who are like 25 year old out of college. So it's not a very rocket science technology, but I think embedding this on a digital platform is like one of the ways the sales have really, really increased. I think this is, now we've talked about just pure visibility, be visible, hope to get offline sales, sell online on other people's platform. We've talked about engagement, we've talked about getting some of those converted into sales. I think the last part of the puzzle is, which is, how do you use influencers and content creators to drive sales? I'm not necessarily the best person to talk about this, but again, one brand you should all check out is this brand called Mamaearth. Has anyone heard of Mamaearth? Very few people. So Mamaearth is my favorite brand. It started as a mother and baby personal care brand. I think they've gone now much wider and become a wider personal care brand. But all their marketing, actually 80% of their marketing budget is actually spent on influencers. And the way they do this, they do two things. One, they work with communities of moms. So they have this 1,000 moms network going, where each new product is actually tried by the mom first. All those 1,000 moms get a free product, they try it out, figure out whether it is working or not, give feedback, product is changed, and then they are the people who are selling it, right? So these are people who have actually used the product, they have actually used it on their children, and they are selling the product through their social media handles, through their videos, et cetera, et cetera, and they get a percentage of sales. The second thing which they've done very interestingly, a lot of time people ask me, how do you really calculate a ROI of a social media influencer? And these guys also learned from example, from a very bad example, and this is no disrespect to Shilpa Shetty, she's a great support, but every time they used to create content through Shilpa, it used to get incredible number of eyeballs, zero sales, right? And the logic was, no one believed that Shilpa uses these products on her children, right? Because you need to be credible when you are talking about, oh, I love this product, please use it, right? So it was like, we've given Shilpa like fair amount of money, we've given her a bunch of equity, and yeah, maybe awareness is increasing, but I don't care about awareness, right? I'm not a general trade selling brand where awareness matters. I want people to see me online and buy me online. And they've completely stopped doing like content with Shilpa. Of course, I'm sure they have their contract obligations, etc. But they've gone on a very other extreme on saying, we only work with influencers. And the way we work with influencers is, is very common. A lot of you may already be using it. Is every content which is created has a code. You go to the company website only where you can redeem the code and you get a 25% discount. So therefore, over a period of time, they build this database where for every influencer, for every type of product, they know how much, every time I pay him, how much is he selling, and therefore what is my ROI behind all of this. Incredible work. You should check out some of the work these guys have done. Disclaimer, I am an investor, but this is not the reason I put the example out here, right? So I think just one page of data, and this is all self-explanatory, so I will not go through this, but I think the only thing this says is, I think a lot of the world is realizing that influencer marketing is going to be critical. Unfortunately, the amount of money spent on this is still very small, right? So, and I think it increased 100% last year, but 100% from zero means nothing, right? So I think you see a lot more money going into this over the next couple of years. I have just one last page. Has anyone heard of these two companies? Okay, I only see two hands. I think the space is evolving so fast that I think I'm still learning digital and the world has moved to video commerce. I think this is the next big thing, and I'm especially a very, very big fan of SimSim. If you find time, I think they've just launched a Google Play Store version and an Android version. It's very, very innovative. I think it's a combination of what you call AI and digital working together, right? So the way SimSim works in a nutshell is it says, Suhail Sameer, Delhi boy, rich, must love booze and guns, right, by and large. And therefore, and probably listens to Mika and does whatever, and drives a BMW, right? So they will use this algorithm and your previous history on e-commerce buying to figure out what sort of products you like, what price point you typically buy at, right? So there's a lot of AI going at the back end to sort of create a image of what type of a consumer you are. I think then on top of that, what they do is you go on the website and or on the app and say, I want an anti-blemish cream, right? Suddenly 10 recommendations will pop up, which will all be AI filtered based on what you buy, what type of products you buy. You buy a Kama, or you buy a Forest Essential, or you buy a Lakme. 10 products will show up. These all 10 products will not be like typical as you go on Amazon and a product is there and like price is there. This is 10 videos of actually content created by influencers. You talking about what is good for the product, what is bad in the product, why you should buy it, why you should not buy it. And these 10 are obviously curated already for you, right? And they know who you follow. So some of the people you follow, if they are one of the people recommending the 10 products, their videos will be on top. And these are all, by the way, genuine videos. These are not, because they don't pay their influencers anything. They have a tie-up with the brands that they cannot pay influencers directly. So influencers only get money as a percentage of sales. So therefore, as an influencer, your credibility, and A, you should believe in the product, you should think it will really work, otherwise you will not waste your money in creating the content and posting it, because if it doesn't sell, then you don't get the money. And if it sells and it's not a great product, then your followers, etc., will not stop believing you and will not buy the products you propagate the next time, right? So it's you literally see 10 videos load up, you go through the 10 videos, you select a product, and you move on. And with the rate how data is becoming faster and cheaper, I genuinely believe SimSim or whoever people will do video commerce, and it's not surprising to believe someone like Amazon will do video commerce, this will become the next $10-20 billion play, right? Because this is using AI already, this is using influencers already, it's using video already, which is mainstream. And what all these guys are trying to do is on top of this add vernacular, right? So So, for example, SimSim already works with 5,000 influencers, and they ensure that they have at least 200, 300 influencers in by and large every state, right? So it's a lot more, and the content therefore is a lot more suited to, et cetera, what you would like to, what you would like to see. I think this is all. I think we are also almost short on time. Great to be here. If you have any questions, I'm happy to take, and otherwise I'm done.
Do we have any questions?
No.
All right, thank you very much. Oh, we've got one.
Hi. I have a very basic question. Partly you have answered it. For your category, which is primarily food, stroke FMCG, so to say, how much role does digital play in product offtake? Not branding, because you spoke about, you know, real sales coming from digital, and that is the expectation a lot of companies, CEOs, marketers have from digital now.
Yeah.
So how does it fit in, and what is, where do you see it going, say, 2-3 years down the line?
So, I think it's an interesting question, and that's something I grapple a lot with, especially for a category. I think food may be slightly better, snacks is probably the worst, right? Because snacks is a very impulse consumption by and large, right? I want a snack packet, I want it now. I am not going to go on Amazon and order a snack packet which will show up at my house 4 days later and then eat it, right? So, and therefore, if you don't have a meaningful conduit to buy online, it many times becomes just an awareness game, and which itself may be meaningful, right? Because a lot of the users have actually moved away from TV. So if you are a conventional TV advertiser, which we are, a lot of metro audience in the 15 to 30 age bracket, which is actually my core DG, is actually no longer watching TV, right? So I may still use digital to get awareness in that audience, but that's a very, sorry to be blunt to some marketeers, that's a very marketeer way of explaining how money is spent, right? So, and awareness is a metric, but awareness for, unless it is complemented with potential sales opportunity or at least consideration, it's not helpful, right? But, so I think I'll tell you how digital helps, and I'll tell you a couple of things from our example I want to avoid 2M, which have really worked. We did a lot of work around the IPL this year on actual consumer engagement, which was, we said, don't run these TV ads on digital and like spend money on it, but actually create content. So we created this game called Karare Strikers, where you can literally take your phone, your screen, someone will bowl on the screen, you play with the bat, you score runs, and based on the runs you score, you get like free 2M delivered to your home, multiple things. And a few other things, a lot of influencers talking about it. I think what that helped, and interventions those still help brands snack brands, is get incredible amount of trials. And these were not free trials because we were giving discounts, etc. So these were paid trials, clear consideration to purchase. I think our IPL time sales, and which IPL time is generally very bad for snack sales because it's school holidays, it is heat, a lot of the snack consumptions happens roadside, tea shop, cigarette shop, which comes down. Our IPL time sales still went up by 27-28% in a month, right? And it's of course very difficult to say what led to it, but I think this was a big influence. And the reason I'm also saying this was a big influence is the other part of my answer, which is a lot of hyper-local delivery coming in, Big Basket, Grofers, your milk basket and all of that, that has actually made the category more amenable to online, right? Because I'm no longer now waiting for 2 days for my snacks to come, but on Big Basket or Milk Basket, I can get it delivered in 2 hours, right? So, and that at least the consideration of evening, there is a party at my home, let me order for that has suddenly gone up, right? So I think over a period of time, I feel that this will become meaningful. For example, for snacks brands, and I'll give you an example. That's why we are investing so much on it, and I can partly already see the rewards. is for snacks category in general, e-commerce and all these hyperlocals, etc., is 0.2% of sales. For 2Yum, it is 9% of sales, right? So we are we're still a very young brand, small brand. So Lay's 0.2% may be like as big as my point, whatever 9%. But the fact that 9% of our sales are coming from e-commerce without doing any significant investment, it is my 5% of media budget right now, is a testament to this is moving, and this is moving very, very fast. And the channels are not your conventional Amazon and Flipkart say we will buy, but the channels are a lot more hypermarket, hyper-local delivery systems like a Milk Basket or a Big Basket. And they are investing a lot on this, by the way. Sorry, please.
Right, we've got another question.
Hi, this is Rohit from Raymond. You mentioned that the way influencers operate, and we've seen it in a lot of social media and also in e-commerce sites, is that discount is a norm, right? So you're spending media monies or money around influencers, you're also offering a discount over here.
Yeah.
And you have other channels of sales as well. So how do you make it a profitable model? When it's conversion led.
No, absolutely. By the way, it's very profitable. I think what we are missing is typically when you offer a code, and that's why you have to do it smartly, and that's why Mama Earth is a great example to look at. Whenever Mama Earth uses the influencer content to give you a discount, it is on Mama Earth website. You can't redeem it anywhere else. So A, they are driving people to their website, increasing followers directly on the website. And B, when you are selling from a website versus Amazon, you are already saving 25% margin, which you are otherwise paying to Amazon, right? So, and the discount is never more than 25%, right? Of course, it can be, but on an average, blended discount is less than that. So, if you use the influencer strategy plus discounting and drive traffic to your website, A, you are driving a more profitable sale than standard Amazon sale. And B, you are getting people onto your website and check a much wider assortment, your website, look and feel, your brand story, versus on Amazon just being able to see the product and the benefits of the product, right? So, and therefore, this has to be more thoughtfully done. Even if you give a discount on Amazon, that's not really helpful, right? You also want consumer data to come in. You also want ROI on the influencer to be calculated, and for that, you need to give a quote, right? So therefore, in fact, I would suggest if you're ever doing a influencer content, you should always give some discount. It may be as low as 10%, because otherwise, if there is no discount, you just say go on website and buy, then you cannot track the ROI of the campaign at all. Sorry, I have to rush. Any of you can reach out to me later.
Thank you very much. Any more questions you can have offline. And may I request Mr. Dhruv Dhawan, Group Head, Accelerator Business, Google India, to come on stage and give a token of appreciation to Sameer. Thank you, Sameer, for a very interesting session.